Welcome back to another episode of Good Question by CoinSchedule TV. So Yoni, thanks very much for coming on the podcast. It's been a long time I've been waiting to talk to you.
Thank you very much for having me.
I know you're a very busy man, so we'll jump straight into everything. So how are you getting on over in Israel?
Awesome. Everybody's here very excited about a couple of our recent announcements. And we're growing rapidly both here and all around the world.
Yeah, congratulations on the acquisition of the smart contract platform.
Thank you very much.
I saw that headline today. I was very impressed to see you making movements into that space.
Yeah, we've been working with a firm that we acquired for a while. So the firm is called Firmo. The founder is a professor of computer sciences and financial engineering in Copenhagen. He actually worked with us on a couple of very interesting proof of concepts of how you create things like leverage on the blockchain. How can you create short on the blockchain? How can you short ERC-20 tokens on decentralized exchanges, for example? How can you create so that what they've developed originally was a block, basically a smart contract, a formally verified language that actually interprets into the EVM of Ethereum, that makes it very easy to write financial contracts and derivatives basically on Ethereum.
Wow, that sounds like it's going to be very important with the merging of traditional legacy systems and crypto.
Exactly. So that's exactly our view. Our view is, we're going to see in the next 5 to 10 years sort of a significant shift from traditional financial services to blockchain-based financial services, and that we're going to see a significant, or maybe the largest, wealth transfer in human history, basically from all types of financial instruments into tokenized financial instruments.
Yeah, I had that quote lined up for you. I have a quote from you, which is that we believe blockchain technology will revolutionize finance and we will see the greatest transfer of wealth onto the blockchain ever, which is such a cool quote from you. When do you think this is all going to happen? Do you think it's inevitable in the next few months, in 2019, 2020, 2021?
Well, if you're thinking about sort of the large scale, then we're looking at the longer duration. The way I look at it, and I think that also relates to where we are right now. So we're still in the sort of midst of crypto winter. So when I started, my passion around capital markets started in the dot-com bubble, roughly like 96, 97, a bit before. And I think this is a very similar cycle. So dot-com bubble, we saw NASDAQ reaching 5,000. And tech stocks getting out of proportion, even pink sheet tech stocks getting out of proportion. And the reason that happened is because a lot of very smart people realized that the internet is a game changer that's going to change the lives of everyone and how people interact with their business and their personal finance, and everything is going to get changed by the internet. And they thought that opportunity to invest in it was back then, 98, 99. But eventually the dot-com bubble sort of burst, right? And then a lot of people thought, okay, so you see the internet is just another medium. It's not that important. And a lot of the core believers, and obviously I was a core believer of the internet, we said, no, it's just going to take maybe longer. And this is very similar. If you're thinking about a transition of trillions of dollars in wealth into the blockchain, it's going to take time. Whether it's 5 years or 10 years, it's hard to estimate, but that's roughly how long it's going to take for the entire financial services industry to move into the blockchain.
Yeah, no, I agree completely. And what do you think are the most significant factors that are stifling this transition?
Well, the fact that it's currently in traditional financial institutions, who are extremely afraid of change, who are not very good at innovation, who are highly regulated, and specifically extremely fearful of crypto. So the majority of money in the world are with extremely conservative players. So technology sort of, you know, disruption in financial services fields actually takes much longer than in other fields.
Yeah, I see what you mean. Especially seeing as we had the burst, the bubble burst at the end of 2017, start of 2018. I'm sure that bad press is stifling people's perceptions of crypto.
My intuition, actually, it's gonna be first used very much on a, let's call it, consumer level, will be very much by the crypto companies, right? So companies such as ourselves, but you know, the Binances and Coinbases of the world, they're gonna be the leaders in innovation as well as we are. On the consumer side, I don't think we're going to see a lot of innovation directed at consumers from traditional financial institutions. I think the game changer for traditional financial institutions is going to be when they realize they can do more complex financial derivatives and financial contracts between themselves at a much lower cost, at much higher frequency. And I think that's really the benefit of smart contracts, to enable you to write things in code rather than in legal documentation.
Yeah, sure. I agree with that completely. And do you think JP Morgan's release of the JPM coin is a good milestone in that banking sector transition?
Definitely. I think, again, when someone like JP Morgan issues a JP Morgan coin, which is pegged to the dollar, and all of their clients know that JP Morgan will convert those JP Morgan coins into dollars whenever they want, it's basically a form of credit, right? Mm-hmm. So JP Morgan can now go to all of their clients and say, okay, each of you got now $50 million of JP Morgan coin, and now you can trade that with me. And every time somebody trades with JP Morgan, they spend money, right? They spend the commission. And JP Morgan could be very comfortable extending that sort of loan or credit to its to other financial institutions that work with them, because they have their own credit risk and risk management, etc. And potentially, from a regulatory point of view, it might actually benefit JP to work with JP Morgan coin rather than with dollars.
Yeah, eventually. I agree with that. And because we were talking about tokenization, and that's the general theme for the podcast, what is your opinion on STOs? Do you think that that will be the main token model that will trigger this tokenization of everything? Or do you see there's problems with STOs, or do you see the problem with the infrastructure and the exchanges? Is that all going to stifle STOs' emergence?
So there's like four sort of different trends or different subjects in tokenization. One is stable coins, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which is pegging a token into an existing asset of value or store of value. That's the process of tokenization, which I'm a very firm believer in. There's STOs, which are initial, which means people are still raising money, which is sort of the next phase of ICOs. The big challenge with ICOs were the fact that they were unregulated. So ICOs were one of the key drivers. There were two big key drivers for 2017 sort of crypto boom. One is China, and the other one is ICOs. Mm-hmm. Those two together sort of fueled the entire growth of the market. The challenge with ICOs was fraud. And it's not only fraud, it's also corporate governance. And corporate governance is not necessarily regulation, but regulation regulates corporate governance, right? Mm-hmm. So, and when I say corporate governance, it's around sort of moral hazard. So if you invest in someone's company through an ICO and you have no rights and he has no obligations to you, and in some cases the founders, so there's clear fraud, which is they raised the money and ran or didn't use it for the purposes they said. And there's indirect, you know, fraud or moral hazard, which is it's not clear what those companies are obliged to, what is the liability for you. And that's really why the entire ICO market also collapsed,
yeah.
is because a lot of those companies failed to deliver on investor expectations in a way which is almost hard to differentiate between fraud, negligence, and moral hazard. STOs, on the other hand, are regulated as securities, right? So it's a security offering. But the problem with STOs is that there are no global regulations. And regulations, by definition, are very local. And the big opportunity of STOs and ICOs, which is raising money, is that instead of you raising money, especially if you're in a country that's different than China and the US, instead of you raising money only from the local investor community, you can suddenly raise money from a global investor community.
Yeah.
And unlike crowdfunding or equity crowdfunding to some extent, you can do that via automated manners. So you don't need to have local lawyers and local accountants to understand what you're investing in, right? There's generic framework. But the problem is there isn't yet generic framework. There aren't yet a lot of platforms which trade STOs. US regulations are relatively very difficult to enable STOs, mostly because there's a requirement for a registry of every single shareholder, which basically means that you need a database to actually represent shareholders as well as blockchain ERC-20 tokens, right? So some regulations in some jurisdictions actually kill the benefit of the blockchain itself, which is a borderless, censorship-less way to exchange peer-to-peer, whether that peer is an individual, accredited investor, or company assets, right? So when you look at a lot of the securities regulations, all of these rules, to some extent, kill a lot of the benefits of the blockchain. By the way, some not. Europe is, for example, a better regulatory framework, I think, for STOs. There's a couple of good jurisdictions for them. Other jurisdictions are just more complicated. And I think it's just going to take time for infrastructure to emerge, for shared liquidity to emerge, and potentially for the need for shared KYC or KYC on the blockchain to emerge before STOs could pick up and become a significant sort of part of the industry.
Mm. But you do still think that STOs will be the predominant form of tokenization that will facilitate the tokenization of everything? No.
No. I actually think the tokenization of existing assets rather than the tokenization of new assets is has bigger potential. If you think today about all of the financial services companies, e-money licenses, etc., it's very hard to simply move your assets off a financial services provider, right? So if you own now stocks in a broker, it's very hard for you to move those stocks into your, it's not very hard, it's impossible to move it to your own wallet, right? You simply can't. You have to move it to another broker, which might take, by the way, in the securities business, weeks, in bonds, maybe impossible, in over-the-counter financial instruments, probably completely impossible. So assets that you have in financial institutions are not necessarily transferable. You can sell them to dollars and then move your dollars, but it's very hard to move them. And I think that's a very big opportunity for blockchain to move it, to basically create that feature of exchangeability and transferability to any type of financial asset, whether it's your apartment or your car or your financial assets in the bank, whether it's your fiat currencies that you want to move to a friend, or whether it's commodities, indices, stocks, bonds, etc.
And to tie all this into your libertarian streak, which I believe you have, is that correct?
Sort of, yes.
Well, that's what it says on your eToro profile, so I was going with it.
It does, but from an economic point of view, not necessarily a political point of view, which takes a different direction.
Yeah, exactly. I'm the same actually. I'm a libertarian leftist, as I like to call it. And to tie that in, so do you think with the tokenization processes that we see happening now, do you think that that's going to be it's going to increase efficiency in the market and then produce more prosperity in societies as a consequence?
So definitely in two parts, or maybe in three parts. One is simply enabling more people to access the global financial markets. For most people, and that has been the vision of eToro from day one. Our vision statement is to open the global markets for everyone to trade and invest in a simple and transparent way. And I can tell you that while initially we thought the biggest challenge is UX, we thought that we just need to build a platform to enable people to sort of experience it in a more enjoyable way. As we build our platform, we realize there is a very big barrier of technology, of just enabling people to transfer and move assets, all types of different financial assets worldwide, even for companies. And I think from that point of view, just enabling access to the markets, whether it's even fiat markets, that potentially creates a much higher level of freedom. The second part is once you can move your financial assets from financial institutions into your own wallet and move it to other places, it creates potentially a much easier way to innovate and build fintech firms. It lowers potentially significantly the requirements of regulation. Again, that will take time for regulators to adapt to that. But people need to understand the reason why regulation is important, and it is important, is because eToro, for example, as a regulated firm, if you come to eToro and you deposit $1 million in eToro, and then 10 other customers each deposit $1 million, we have $11 million. We're required by regulation at the end of every day to show that we have an account, which is a customer account, which has $11 million, and that account actually belongs to our customer from a legal point of view. It's our account in trust to our clients, and that has to be reconciled and checked daily. If you think about unregulated exchanges, for example, there's a good chance that a significant part of unregulated exchanges, you have those 11 people each depositing $1 million, but those $11 million being used for corporate purposes, for marketing, and they're not there. And if the entire $11 million or 11 people try to each to withdraw all of their funds, they might find out that the exchange is actually insolvent, right? So that's one of the, I think that's the most important reason for regulation, is to make sure that you as a client know that when you deposit funds into the company, there's a good process and sort of somebody's regulating that process, making sure that the company actually custodies your funds properly and separately from the firm's funds. If you think about a potential tokenized asset future and potentially decentralized finance and decentralized exchanges, then in that envisioned future, you can build a lot of very cool financial services without the need to actually be the custodian, right? Without the tech firm, without the fintech firm need to actually hold your money in order to do something. They can just write the tech, charge you something for the money going through them, but never actually holding your funds, which would mean there's a much less regulatory requirements potentially from them. But again, that will take time for that sort of lenient regulation on just tech firms to sort of evolve. And I think the third part, and that's a big part of what we're building, I don't know if you've heard about the Good Dollar Project.
Is that the universal basic income?
Yeah. So
Yeah.
that is, I think, the by far biggest potential of blockchain, period, is the unbanked. And on top of that, which is a problem that is as big as the unbanked. So there's more than 2 billion people in the world that don't have a bank account. They can't open a bank account.
I think it's more than that. I did some research into this. It was at 1.7 billion by World Bank's estimates, but they only included male heads of household. So it's closer to 3, 4 billion, really.
Which is insane. And the reason is, again, relates to the previous one. Regulators are regulating more and more. They're constantly adding more regulation, which means it's becoming harder for firms to actually serve more people, right? Without complete automation, etc. And I think blockchain has the potential of enabling financial services. And again, relating to the first point of opening the markets, right? So if assets are going to get tokenized, and you're going to get all types of assets as tokens, and now you have more people with, you know, either Ethereum wallets or blockchain-based wallets around the world than a bank account, then suddenly more people have access to the markets. And when people have access to the markets, they have opportunity. And when they have opportunity, they can come out of poverty. They can get paid for delivering goods and services online. They can participate in the global economy, in the internet economy. And I think that also opens up opportunities for things like the good dollar, which is enabling some type of universal basic income for just a bigger cohort of people.
Yeah, I agree. There's have you seen the service now where you can transfer, when you can transact Bitcoin with SMS texts? Have you seen that? Yeah. So that's I gave a talk a few weeks ago and I was trying to describe that to people. And I said that you can go into like a sub-Saharan community, give them 100 smartphones, or not even smartphones, sorry, like very basic old Nokias, just with SMS functionality, a few solar panels, and they can create their own economy irrespective of geographical location or democratic institutions. And then they can just start slowly but surely to build their own micro economy and then over time expand that out. And it's an incredible functionality that was not here a decade ago.
If you think about the beautiful thing of smart contracts and a big part of this ecosystem, which is open source. So if you create, you know, open source smart contracts for micro lending and for micro finance, and then eventually build smart contracts code for sort of this bank, right, fractional reserve banks on the blockchain, and that code is also open source. You could have innovation coming from every single country in the world suddenly trickling to, you know, to any place, whether it's Asia, Africa, you know, Middle East and Europe or the Americas. So you can suddenly have innovation, which is, you know, someone developed a smart contract which does something really cool in one place and it's open source, and suddenly that moves into a completely different place without actually people moving. Which is very different, again, than traditional financial services, where you would have somebody actually set up a local company with local processes and operations and regulations, people-based, knowledge-based, and everything would sort of get stuck there, even if somebody was able to innovate. Mm-hmm. Wouldn't be able to sort of travel around the internet. But if this revolution is open source and written in code and smart contract code, then I think the opportunities for that to sort of become viral is very interesting.
Yeah, it's fascinating. Just talking about it now, I can imagine the kind of, you know, Wix.com, where you can go and choose your website template. Imagine if you could go to like an equivalent and choose your decentralized autonomous organization template and just input some user wallets, and that's how you integrate an organization.
So funny enough, the founder of Wix is a good friend of mine, Avishai.
Tell him to contact me. I'll build it with him.
I'm trying to take him through the rabbit hole of crypto. But there's now a company also that ICO'd last year called DAOStack. And what they're doing is actually building an infrastructure for DAOs. So their envisioned future is exactly that people will be able to sort of define your decentralized autonomous organization, define the governance, define how voting works, click enter, boom. Now people can participate.
Wow, imagine that.
Yeah.
And then when you can start integrating that into like token funding mechanisms, like, you know, the DICO that was tried last year,
Of course.
The problem with Dicos was that they were too rigid, and as with all small startups, they changed so many times over the first couple of months of operations that you need that fluidity. Whereas Dicos created too much of a rigid structure. So, like in the future, I envision a kind of world where you can have like a VC model done through DAOs and then also integrated with token fundraising, which would be quite interesting.
Again, I'm very familiar because eToro is a regulated financial institution, and I have background in sort of also traditional finance. To set up, an ETF today, by the way, you can see it, right? Look how long it takes for a Bitcoin ETF to emerge in the U.S., right? You actually have the you need to the regulator to approve it. In Israel, by the way, in order for Israel to launch a Bitcoin ETF, the regulator in Israel said we need first the U.S. regulator to approve it,
Yeah,
which is
crazy.
completely, by the way, unclear what exactly are they supposed to approve, right? What is an ETF? It's an exchange traded fund. It's basically a pool of investments of people who want to invest in Bitcoin. So first of all, I'm not a big believer in really the reason why we need ETF, at least for retail investors. They can just go and buy Bitcoin, which is much better. Period. But if you think about pooled investing, what you write pooled investing code in about 10 minutes in a smart contract, right? So five different people send Ethereum into a smart contract. That pooled investment now can invest in different tokenized assets, right? And they each hold a share of how much they originally invested, and therefore anyone can actually withdraw the actual benefit. So it's very easy to think about structures that are 100%, 5,000% more efficient and effective than traditional financial markets like ETFs or ETNs or ETPs or all these structures just in smart contracts. It's just a process that's going to take time.
Yeah, well, it's the equivalent of like smart contract programming on its most leading edge is basically rocket science for developers. It is the equivalent. And earlier you spoke about stable coins and that you're interested in the future evolution of stable coins. Why are stable coins so important for crypto and why are they relevant?
So I want to sort of take it even more macro. I think to tokenized assets, that's the big story of the blockchain and the next story. Sort of already being told, but yet to be executed properly. I think that the ability to transfer assets from one person to another, from one, P2P online, that doesn't really exist today. It's very hard. If we try to close a deal now and to move euros and dollars between me and you, that's really non-trivial. Doing it through the bank is horrible. We're in different countries. It will probably take a week. Doing it through another type of service, we'll both need to set up that service specifically. We won't be able to use any global infrastructure for it. And also, if we were able to agree on something, it would probably be moving euros, pounds, or dollars. Definitely, you won't be able to accept shekels from me. But more than that, if I want to send you 1 ounce of gold or 1 ounce of silver, or 1% of my apartment in Tel Aviv, that's completely impossible. And I think tokenization of traditional assets opens up the market for so many opportunities for new types of services, for more efficient clearing and settlement and exchange of assets, that we haven't even touched the surface. And that's why I think that's the biggest thing we're going to see in the next 12 to 18 months is the tokenization of traditional financial assets. Or other types of assets like art and real estate. And throughout that process, sort of new types of usage that emerge into that process.
And so stablecoins present a unique opportunity then. So that's what you're saying. And is that simply as a entrance from traditional finance into crypto? Do you think that's the primary role?
So I think eventually blockchain. No, so I think blockchain is eventually going to eat financial services.
Agreed. Yeah, I agree with that.
And if you think of financial services, it's about traditional financial assets. So I think by taking traditional financial assets and tokenizing them, moving them into the blockchain, that is the process of how the blockchain eats traditional financial services.
Right.
Because if you simply think about the following, so you have two stores or online stores selling you gold, right? One sells you gold that you can't transfer or move to anyone else, and that you can only buy the gold there and sell the gold there. The other one is selling you gold that you can transfer to anyone you want, whenever you want, and you can actually also list it on other, sort of take it to your own wallet, put it in your own safe, that tokenized version, move it to another place and then sell it there. Which one would you prefer? If they cost the same.
Yeah, the one where when I get the asset, yeah.
Right? The one where you can actually move it. Where, yeah. Because it's a feature, right? It's like car windows that you used to have non-automatic car windows. Once you have that feature in assets, that's how blockchain eventually eats traditional financial services, is through tokenization of assets. And then through smart contract applications that basically create a new level of efficiency and innovation in the exchange of assets.
And speaking of that, do you see central banks like the American and British Central Bank releasing their own stable coins or their own replacement to the traditional currencies at any point in the future?
I almost think it's inevitable. So central bank digital currencies has now been sort of researched, I think, by more than 50 different central banks.
Mm-hmm.
And I think in the long term, it is inevitable. Whether you would call those crypto assets or not, that's a very big question, because it's probably going to be permissioned rather than permissionless.
Mm-hmm.
And it's probably going to be controlled by the government, which you can argue whether how centralized or decentralized that entity is, depending, of course, on the different governments. But I think, you know, digitization is inevitable, right? Moving from paper and coins to something that's digital, I think it's very obvious that that's inevitable. Now the question I think is only when and how, not if.
I would agree with that. And when it comes to cryptocurrencies released by central banks versus Bitcoin, there's a good saying which I spoke about with you when we first met in London, which is that first they ignore you, then they laugh at you, then they fight you, then you win. And at the point when they start releasing their own cryptocurrencies, I think that's their attempt to fight. That's their attempt to hold on to the control over these systems. But inevitably, they will have lost at that point. Do you agree with that sentiment?
I regardless of sort of, I'm a peaceful person. So regardless of fighting, I think that by creating central bank digital currencies, they will eventually legitimize Bitcoin. Because if it's truly a transferable digital currency, it'll be almost impossible not to enable people to convert Bitcoin into them and vice versa,
yeah.
Right? Again,
yeah.
Depending on the level of freedom that they enable in that currency. And again, it's all about, it's fiat is gonna suddenly get features. And those features are gonna be very important, and those features will define a country's level of freedom, right? So the feature of your digital identity and how easy or complex it is to start a company right now, those things are being measured all around the world. You can see the level of freedom and efficiency of different countries in sort of different surveys and researches. I think the type of features that specific countries fiat currency has is something that's, that people are going to look at their level of freedom.
I agree. And my last question on smart contracts, my last question on stablecoins, do you see the future of stablecoins being smart contract governed like MakerDAO?
I think they both exist. I think MakerDAO is super interesting, probably the most used and best example of smart contract code that's actually applicable and people are using it today. So brilliant team, brilliant execution, and very impressive results. But I think both exist. I think we'll see more sophisticated smart contract-based assets, but I think we'll also see sort of traditional financial assets being pegged into tokenized assets through through trust attestations, etc. So if you think about it, USDT is still significantly higher than MakerDAO, which is smart contract based, but it's also much significantly higher than USDC and than Gemini and Circle, who are both regulated in New York as a trust charter, where USDT, nobody knows exactly how, it's not regulated, who stands behind it, how they're covering it, etc., etc. But nonetheless, USDT is still the biggest player. Why? Because Bitfinex enables the perception and of conversion of USDT to dollars is easier there than it is of other cryptos to those assets.
Yeah, there's a serious problem with lack of transparency with Tether.
I think it's lack of perceived transparency or lack of regulation. But I think eventually, because they enable the conversion of USD to USDT, then sort of that's how they prove every time they do that conversion that it's backed.
Yeah. True. And so my final question to you, because I know you're a busy man and need to get back to all your everything else. What is eToro's role going to be in the crypto revolution?
We're going to take a very big part in tokenization of assets and enabling people a simple and easy way to access tokenized assets in the global markets, which we've been doing for the past 12 years. And that's basically, you know, our vision is to open the markets for everyone to trade and invest. And our mission is to just provide a simple and easy to use platform for people to be able to access the global markets, tokenized assets, and enable also the conversation around that. So that's really our purpose and what we've been delivering on.
Yeah, I'm sure you'll be able to do it. I have faith in you, Yoni.
Thank you very much.
All right. Well, thanks very much for your time. It's been a really interesting conversation.
Perfect. And always happy to update you after a couple of interesting announcements that we have in the next couple of months.
Yeah, that sounds good. And let me know next time you're in London. We'll go for a drink.
Perfect. Thank you very much.
All right. Thanks, Yoni. Talk soon.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Thanks for watching. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel and share this video with your friends.